Hi, my name is Margaret Applin, and I've got some brand new stencils that I am dying to introduce to you. My newest stencils are collection-based in design, and this means that all of the designs within the named collection are similar in look and feel. The scale of the designs are slightly larger than my previous designs, making them perfect for art quilting, home decor, and wall art, while still applicable to art journaling and smaller scale projects. Although all of the stencils can be purchased separately, what each collection offers is the opportunity to expand the design experience of the user. The stencils of a collection become the building blocks to create a visual story and help take the guesswork out of selecting coordinate designs. We're going to be using a variety of tools today for the two projects that we're going to be making, and I want to just talk briefly about those. I have a variety of paints here, from Distress Paints by Tim Holtz to Dina Wakely's line. Her turquoise is one of my favorite colors. I also have some Jacquard textile color, which is fabric paint, and some Sharpie markers, the water-based Sharpie paint pens, which are great. Disappearing ink pen for marking fabric. Some painter's tape or masking tape is good. I have a variety of foam applicators, including a high-density foam roller and some other types of foam applicators. It's always good to have a variety, as well as some paintbrushes as well. We're going to be working on canvas for one project, and you have the choice of working on a large canvas that's approximately 20 inches by 20 inches, or four smaller canvases that we would work on together as one project. Additionally, we're going to need some foam core, and foam core usually comes in standard size boards of 20 inches by 30 inches, and it's about 3/16 inch thick. So I usually get a few of those. And one of the things that we're going to be doing is cutting up some pieces of foam core and stacking it together that we will use as a special tool when we get to working on our canvas project. The stencil collection that I'm going to be working with to create my pillow is the Becca collection. And I wanted to just show you a little bit about this collection really quick. The collection is actually three different stencils. And of course, all of these are sold separately, but you can buy the entire collection and have the ability to use all of the similar imagery that's created in the full collection. So what each collection consists of is at least one large corner design that can be seamlessly rotated to create a large medallion. So Becca is kind of based on a more floral and curvy line design, and what you see here is the medallion quarter, as well as an additional half circle design, which each of these designs is going to contain registration marks. So every time you're going to rotate a design, it's got a pivot point, which is the point here that you can see, and these dots are large enough for you to put a pencil or a tack through. So each rotating design is going to have registration marks. So there's going to be one up here, one down here, and a pivot point. The semicircle here has registration marks here so that you can simply flip the design and just line everything up. And I'll show you the registration marks as I start to stencil this. This stencil part of Becca is a seamless repeat in both horizontally and vertically. So there are four registration marks that will allow you to line it up perfectly, either vertically or horizontally. And you can get a seamless repeat pattern that you're printing across a larger piece of fabric or surface. Additionally, there are individual stems in Becca that are really cute to add just simply for a little excitement or additional embellishment here or there, depending upon how you want to use it. And the third stencil for Becca contains a set of three medallions that can be repeated horizontally or vertically. There are no registration marks for this. And the other coordinate which you can repeat over a large area of fabric or surface as well. There is no registration mark for this because it's pretty much pretty easy just to line up and repeat across the surface. So this is the set that we're going to be working with, and I'm going to start demoing how to stencil this design right here as our center medallion. So I've cut down my foam core board into a smaller size, which is about 20 by 20. And what I'm going to do is use my adhesive very lightly. I'm going to spray it across the surface of this board very lightly. And I'm just going to let it air out a little bit. And I've already got a piece of fabric here that I'm going to be using that I've already pre-painted. And what I'm going to do is simply pull that piece of fabric right onto the foam core board. And I'm just going to, with my hands, kind of push out any of the wrinkles. And this is going to be great because it's going to hold that piece of fabric in place while we stencil. So it's stuck down and we don't need to worry about that shifting. And that's a huge consideration when you want to stencil on fabric. So I've got my stencil right here. And before I get started, what I like to do is take the painter's tape and just mask off those areas that I might roll over with my paint roller and just avoid that from printing onto my fabric. Additionally, I have a couple of little pieces that I'm going to use to cover the actual registration marks when I roll the paint on. And that also will prevent any marks from the registrations that we don't want to end up on our fabric. So what I plan to do here is I'm going to select my pivot point, and I'm going to take my tack, and how I'm doing this is actually just eyeballing it, but basically I want to make sure that I have enough space all the way around my design, that I've got some seam allowance to be able to work this into my pillow, and it's kind of tight there. So I'm just going to pull this in. If you needed to, you could actually use a ruler to find the center of this. My eyeballs are usually pretty good sometimes. So I'm actually going to go right here, and I'm going to put my tack right in that registration point, in that pivot point. So using my fabric marker, this is the one Fine Point Disappearing Ink, I'm going to actually mark out, place a dot right inside those registration marks right here and right here. And while this is still holding tight in the center here, I'm going to find my registration mark here, which I know is hard to see, and I'm just going to mark the next one. And I'm going to continue to do this until I've gone all the way around the circle. Check that registration mark and just put a dot in the next one. And then I should be good to go when I've reached my last registration mark, and there I can find it again, and I see that this one is also lined up. So I know that the fabric is not going to shift while I'm actually stenciling on it. Now what I've done is I mixed up some slightly orange paint here, and I'm using my 2-inch foam roller with the high density foam brush on it, and I have not added any water to my paint, so I've strictly got the red, the orange, red and yellow, and the opaque white, and then I've also got some colors extender in there. So this foam brush is going to hold a lot of paint, so you don't need to thin it down or anything. We don't want that paint to actually go through our stencil and muddy up our design. The last little thing I'm doing here is taking a little bit of tape and placing it over those registration marks so that I can easily block those. However, one step that we want to take before that is just to get an additional piece of blue tape. And while we can see that we're centered over our registration marks, let's just put that there. It's going to hold that stencil right in place. I'm going to place my little blue tape over the registration marks, and now I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to start rolling my paint across. Now, because this foam roller is high density, the results are going to be great. You may have to go over it a few times, and I don't recommend going in full force right away. So the more pressure you put on this roller, the more paint that's gonna come out of it. So you just want to kind of get used to, and maybe you want to test this a little bit before you go and do it on your fabric, to kind of get the feel for how much pressure you actually can use on this. Now, when I get closer down to the center here, I could try and force this roller in there to get to those marks, or I could actually take one of these little stamp tools and go right in here and do that. A couple of the edges. So now that I have completed one quarter of the circle, I'm going to lift my little tape pieces off, put those aside, untape this by just lifting the stencil up. And now with my pivot point still in there, I'm going to rotate the design until I can match up those registration points again that I've already marked out. And once I do that, I'll just secure the tape again, add my little blue tape pieces so that I don't roll over them, and then again start applying my paint. And as you go along and you use up more paint on the roller, you can just press a little bit harder, or you can go back into your tray and add more paint. You might want to anchor your stencil with your hands additionally, so that, depends upon how rough you are, and I tend to go in and I love rolling, so I'm like rolling right along all over the place. And I tend to use more pressure sometimes. So, like I said, this is a great tool, this roller, and I use it all the time. Now, if you wanted to use a traditional stencil brush, that's definitely something to consider. Stenciling by nature has been something of a lighter application using a dry stencil brush. So the way I'm kind of using these stencils is I'm actually printing through my stencils on fabric. So I've lined up my registration marks again, and my center point is still here. I'm going to cover up my little registration marks again. Get a little more paint on my roller, which might be uneven based on the color mixing, but I'm okay with that. I like that because it will it'll change up going around the petals. Now, additionally, you don't have to select one paint color to roll over this entire design. You could actually use a variety of rollers in a variety of colors that blend together. Like, you could start with yellow in the center, and you could use peach going outwards, and then red on the edges to really get more of a feel for a gradation that you're creating that way. So once again, I'm on to my last rotation here. I'm going to take my little registration tape pieces off there and lift this up. And one more time, I'm rotating. I'm going to find my registration marks right here. And I'm going to put this piece of tape in a different spot off this edge. Cover up my little registration marks, and I'm good to go. So that's easy. Really, it doesn't take a lot to reposition the stencil if you've prepared those registration marks ahead of time. And this roller is a great tool to use when covering a larger area. And the Jacquard textile color paints for fabric are fabulous, and they're heavy enough that you don't need to mix any water with it like we did on the painting of the fabric. This is heavy body enough with the foam roller that you won't have any bleeding underneath that stencil as you roll it out. So again, I'm just going to get in there with my little foam thing here, and I'm just going to go along the edges, and I can take my pivot point out now because this was the last turn, and I'll lift that stencil off, And you can work out this little split in the fabric once you iron and heat set your fabric. But that is how easy it was to create this rotating design to create a medallion. And again, this is about approximately 15 inches in diameter. Between 12 and 15 are most of the design diameters. So we're going to use this to incorporate into our pillow. Well, I've stenciled my fabrics, and I'm kind of auditioning what I want to use to pull together my pillow. So I just wanted to show you how the pieces that I'm actually using. I've incorporated some commercial fabrics like this cute little polka dot here, as well as this herringbone white textured fabric behind here, which is always great to do. You don't need to strictly limit yourself to only your hand stenciled or hand painted fabrics. It's good to incorporate other textures and that don't actually draw away from the statement that your stencil fabrics are making. So anything kind of low key and that blends in with the rest of the fabrics. So just a little sneak peek at that, and I'm gonna start thinking about how I want to pull my pillow pieces together, and I'll show you in the next step. So as you can see, I've selected the stenciled images that I wanted to incorporate into my pillow, and I'm also entertaining the option of creating a crochet border that will be attached to the pillow before I do the final construction as well. So this is how I'm building out my pillow top, and I've actually I cut off the medallion that I originally stenciled, and I rough edge applicate it using free motion stitching on the machine to the white background of my pillow. And I used that coordinate, that quilting fabric that has that white herringbone print on it, which I think is really cool. And it kind of lends itself to this this vertical direction that your eye is following as you travel from the main design focal point up to the top of the border of the pillow. So I'll come back to you shortly with the finished product so you can see how it ended. One of my newest design stencils is actually called the Circle Master Template. And this is what it looks like in the packaging, and I'm sure it's not very impressive whatsoever. However, the reason I put this together is because I figure, since I am somebody who loves to have guidelines that will help me create in my artwork, that other people might also enjoy the ability to create guidelines to construct their own. So basically, I'm going to be showing you one way that you can use this template, and this is what the template looks like. It's probably easier for you to see this way. There are a number of different cuts in this template, and the center marks are for pencil or pen. These larger circles are actually for doing applications on fabric, which I'll get into in another video. And the straight line marks here are also to be used with the pencil marks here. These two on the left-hand side are just additional embellishments once you create a circle using this template that you can further, you know, stamp fabric, stencil fabric through, fabric paint through, or just on regular paper and canvas. So what I want to show you today is how I use these two pencil marks to be able to create a design for wall art. So, you know, one of the things I really want to do is work a little bit bigger and be able to spend more time on a project and have something that I can actually display. So this is kind of my reasoning and my logic for developing this stencil. So my first example is this. So basically, what my template does is help you create circles of in a variety of sizes, and the template will allow you to create a medallion that's actually about 22 inches in diameter. So what this also does is it allows you to create different size circles all while you're tacked to a central pivot point. So this is an example of one piece that I already created using this template, and you could use this on a journal page. It's much easier to use it on a free piece of paper or something like that, outside of a journal, where it might get a little more complicated, where you've got the pages and the spine. But again, I see this more for a larger application. So what I want to show you that I'm hiding underneath here is my partially done series using that template. So basically what I've done, and I'm going to show you how to do, is I've got four canvases that are all the same size. These happen to be 12 by 12, and I've gessoed them already, and they're dry. But I'm also going to show you what happens if you use one large canvas. So let's get started, and I'll walk you through how I use this template in order to create wall art. The tools that you're going to need for this first part includes nothing but a pencil, some painter's tape, some foam core and a tack, and of course whatever canvas you want to use. I'm going to start with the large canvas here, but what I want to show you is that you want to be able to anchor this stencil on something outside of your canvas. And what I've simply done is just stacked up four pieces of the standard foam core and taped them together. This is probably a little over an inch in height, and most canvases are about 3/4 inch, so you definitely want something that's going to be higher than the canvas itself. It'll make it easier for when you start using the template. But you want to create one of these, or if you have a soft piece of pine wood and it's thick enough, you could use that as well. And this is going to be where we anchor our stencil. So again, when we're talking about the stencil, each column of cutouts here has the bottom hole, which is actually the pivot point, and that's where this will be anchored. So I'm just going to stick that in there for now. What I need to do additionally is I'm first going to show you on the larger canvas. This is a 20 by 20 canvas, and I have my block of foam core here, and what I want to do is just cut another piece of tape that I can use as I shift this pivot point here. I want to be able to hold it down to the table. So I'm simply going to run another piece of tape over that, and it will pretty much hold there and in place. You want to be able to have enough tape that it goes all the way over that block and really anchor it, and it'll stay pretty secure. So now that I have this, I'm going to start by showing you that you can place your pivot point anywhere you want. Obviously, on a straight line, if you start your pivot point over here, that means that your circles will fall in line more from the corner. So wherever your pivot point is where you're going to be drawing your circle lines. Now you can move this continuously through the process, throughout the process, and draw as many circles as you want. So I'm going to stop talking, and I'm actually going to start my pivot point actually over here. You can take this off to start. I'm going to place my little cube right here and my pivot point. And this doesn't have to be in the center. I'm going to put it in the center. And I want to show you that you can easily move this. But when you pivot it, you want to make sure that you have nothing else that's in the way, or else you'll get a little frustrated trying to get over and caught on things that might be around it. So just give yourself enough space to play. And I'm going to simply start by holding my pencil in one of these holes and just pushing the template across so that I can make a mark. And while it's still in this pivot position, I wanna create another circle, and maybe I even wanna go super huge, and I'm gonna use that, the biggest circle position here. So what I wanna do, and what I recommend doing, is actually turning the canvas and placing your pivot point at different places on each side. So I'm gonna tape my little block here again, and I'm gonna stick my tack right in here. And now I'm gonna draw as many circles as I want, and this is slightly off center. I do wanna have some small ones as well as some large ones. So I'm simply going to place my pencil there. I think maybe a thin border. So I just simply move up to the next hole in the template here. So you can see through the stencil and actually kind of realize where you're drawing those lines. And I think I'll put one right here. And then I really want another large one, but I won't go fully to the top. I'll start with the this hole here because it's not off the canvas yet. And I'm just gonna pull that all the way around and see where that goes. So you can see kind of what I'm doing, and I don't need to do this on every side. I can actually place my pivot point in a really weird location, like way off the edge of my way off the edge of my canvas here. And you can see now here are my lines, my markings, and I may just go in and do some much smaller ones off of this corner. And you can ignore these lines. If you make too many lines, you can ignore them when you go to actually build out your design. So I think maybe I'm just gonna throw in a couple of bands here, which means I'm just gonna select the next cutout just to create a thin border around that. Now, there's one more thing that I wanna show you, and this is completely up to you. I don't have any fear when I play this way. So I'm actually going to stick my block underneath my canvas. And I think maybe I want to put my block right here. I'm actually going to make a hole right through the canvas, and I'm going to anchor that right there. And I don't care, you can paint over that, you can make the hole disappear later and put tape behind it or something. But it's gonna allow me to create from a completely different location within this canvas. So one additional thing that I wanna show you is, I know we haven't talked about the straight line mark. So, oops, let me go in and darken that. I've got a pencil here that is, you have to keep hitting the bottom of it. Anyway, so I've got my lines here. I can always erase what I don't want to use. So anyway, let's move on to the straight line here. And using the same pivot point that I have already marked for this angle, I could simply go through however many of these circles I want to. And right now I'm just going to limit it to the one that I created using this pivot point. But here I can simply create some more guidelines. And this will allow me to section the design that I'm working on. And this can get more interesting, or you can ignore those lines if it comes down to not feeling like they're benefiting you as you build out your design. And of course you could always go in with a ruler after that. However, this is always going to continue to keep you in that center pivot point, which means that all those lines are going to be exactly the same, pulling straight out from that center mark. So like I said, you can paint over this, and you can put some tape under there and fix that hole. So it really it's not too big of an issue. I want to show you what happens when you put four canvases together and you do that, which is exactly what I did for the one I showed you that's almost completed. And just got stuff all over here. Anyway, most of these canvases will pretty much fit together. However, these are from the craft store and they're not always the best canvases. So anyway, using the methodology that I just showed you, I'm going to be placing my block anywhere. And I'm going to continue to rotate these, but at the same time, I'm not only going to rotate them, but once I draw lines, I'm going to rotate the individual ones and position them differently as I continue to draw more circles, and that'll create the look that I showed you from on the large one. So here I've got my pivot point over here, which you can see, and I'm just going to stick my stencil, the pencil mark one, in here and just show you that now I have the ability to draw those lines across more than one canvas. And you can go super crazy with this. I recommend doing just a couple of marks and then changing the position of the canvases. So here, I'm just going to turn the entire thing this way. Reposition them. You could tape them if you wanted to. I don't really feel like, I like to kind of move faster than that. So I'm going to stick my pivot point up here now. I think I'll like just tape down my block right there and see what happens, and put my pivot point right in there. And here I'm just going to create a couple. You can tape them together if you want. I'm just going to create a couple of lines that cross both canvases. And then I'm going to, actually I really want a small one in here, so I'm going to draw that right there. So you can see, as you continue to kind of change these up, you can literally go around the entire set, moving it all together, or you can start changing them up one at a time. If it's easier for you to work off of one side with your block, then definitely do that. So there's just such a huge variety of ways that you can change this up, that really it's all just, it's play, and you just need to discover everything that you can do with it. And my block just moved, so just make sure your tape is secure. You may need to use either a stronger tape or just replace that painter's tape because it comes free easily. So anyway, I'm going to continue doing this around here. And then also on a larger scale, like we did on the first canvas, I can go in and I don't have to cross the lines either. Every motion I make, every pencil line I put down is completely intuitive. I'm just playing. I won't end up using what I don't want to use. And I go from there. So while this block is in the same place, I'm going to move it over so I can... Oops, I had the wrong pivot point. I'm going to put my stencil back into that same hole, only under the right template, just like this. And now you can see how I can actually create sections within those circles. And this is for a little bit later when I show you when you can start to build out collage on top of your circles. So in addition to painting sections of it, you could use your printed deli papers and collage those. So I'm going to be doing a little bit of this on the large canvas so you can see how you can really fully use this template. Well, here I am after I have finished marking out my circle lines using the Circle Master template. And I just started filling in some areas of color. I'm using Dina Wakely's Media Heavy Body Acrylic Paint and her gel medium, Soft Gel Matte Medium. And I can't tell you how much I am in love with her turquoise color. This is such an incredible color and I just want to eat it. So I've like covered a lot of my canvas in this color already. But what I also have going on are a number of printed and stenciled deli papers that I'm going to use for collage in the next step here. So I wanted to show you how I kind of go about using the deli paper. For an example, I can still see all my lines. If you wanted to lighten up your pencil lines, you could definitely do that by going over it maybe with a sponge brush before you started painting. I like how when I run my paintbrush along that line, it darkens a little bit. So, you know, if it was still really dark, I would erase it. But I'm fine with it, and I just like to see what happens when I add the paint. So if I'm going to use a piece of deli paper that I've already printed, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take my pencil and position the deli paper over that area that I want. And I'm just going to kind of mark out the circle on the deli paper so I can still see it. And I'm just going to, you know, kind of fussy cut it. And actually, I'm not going over the green, so I can just mark this section of the circle and cut it from there. So what I will do is I will start cutting up my deli paper. And I can actually do that right now. Just to show you, I can just put some white paint on my brush here, and this is a Liquitex. I don't have white Dina paints, so basically I'm just going to go over those lines a tiny bit with the white just to tone them down even more. And because this is acrylic and the gel medium's acrylic, I'm just going to go right over that same area with the gel medium so that I can adhere my deli paper right to it. And again, I'm not worried about the pencil mark. I think that'll disappear eventually with everything that I'm going to have going on over it. And I just really want to cover this area so that I make sure that deli paper stays down right along the edge there. And I take my deli paper and I'm just gonna attach it like that. And then what I like to do is I like to take an old credit card or some other kind of flat surface, and obviously I don't have enough gel medium under here, so let me go back in and do that. Really put some in there. And now when I use my card just to smooth it out, it's going to stick better and get all the air bubbles out. A lot of times what I like to do when I'm working on canvas is to actually have some foam core sitting underneath this to build up the surface, so I have that stability, which will allow me to really put some pressure on this deli paper and get those air bubbles out and any extra gel medium that I have off the edges. And for whatever runs over that pencil mark, it's either not going to bother me in the end, or I will go in with an X-Acto knife and just kind of start to cut those little edges right there. But for the most part, this is my technique. So now I'm going to work around using all my printed deli papers and kind of fit pieces in where I think they might look great, and then just kind of audition some other ones. And then I'll come back and I'll work some paint pen and markers into the detail. Finish up the detailing on my canvas, I'm now going to use some Sharpie paint pens. These are water-based paint pens, mostly black and white, and Joggles carries a variety of weights. There's fine point, extra fine point, So I'm putting the final touches on my canvas wall art here, and I know there's a lot that I didn't show you, but basically what I've done is I've gone in with my Sharpie paint pens, the water-based paint pens that Joggle sells, and I've actually created a very sketchy line look. You know, and I've gone around every band of color or every band of deli paper and accented the edge with that, and then gone in and added additional white highlights in different areas. So additionally, what I did was I took my my master circle template that I used to create this design with the gold paint pen, and I actually positioned a few of these decorative dots. Went in and used my paint pen and just kind of put some gold paint in there and rubbed it around with my finger. And then when that dried, I went in and highlighted those and circled those in black. The only cross lines that I did keep from using this part of the template were the areas down here below, which I was fine with that. You know, I had some other lines that I incorporated into my design originally, but I erased them and painted over them, and I was fine with that. Additionally, this is a great project for you to incorporate, you know, your own stamps and stencils. I went back to, I know this is a scary looking stencil, but I can't wait to like spray this with water and then like let it dye the fabric that I place it on. But long story short, I went in and I used my star stencil, my shooting star stencil, just to create a bold statement within that solid color area. And I did it by making scratchy lines out of those stars, and then went in and added a couple more that to fill in this empty space here. So basically, when you look at this overall design, it incorporates printed deli papers. So I had some random pieces that I printed that are here and also over here and in this section here. And then I've incorporated deli paper that I printed using my new stencils from the Jess collection over here and, you know, in this area over here. So there's kind of a nice balance as to the difference in pattern that's going on here. It doesn't feel super crazy. So I have a tendency to go super crazy, but I think I kind of held back a little bit here. So I'm just going to end up finishing this up by going in and putting some of these little triangles here, making them very black to add a little bit more of a statement on this center circle here. And from there, I consider it done. And here's a great piece that I can now go hang on my wall, give to my niece for her to hang in her bedroom, or, you know, it's a great gift. So I will be following up with more videos this way to show you what else you can do with the Master Circle template and creating art on fabric as well.